preach a sermon with music playing the entire time. And I will make my wife and my friends here. I'm a teacher, so, you know, you learn that with music, it actually, when you hear something, it actually goes into a different part of your brain, it's more likely to sink in. You know, so, and it also makes something happen with time because you're in the creative side of your brain, so you're not getting bored while someone's talking for an hour. But just start out with prayer. I kind of touched on something there during worship that I wanted to pray about before I kind of go into what I was talking about, what I plan on talking about today, which is already spoiler alert. So, you know, just the climate that we're in right now. You know, it's an election year, and it seems to be things are just in my lifetime. I mean, I can imagine some of you that go back a little bit further than me. It's just gotten more and more polarizing every year. It just gets more and more polarizing. And I think that is a plan of the enemy, you know? I think that a lot of times we get caught up in the politics, and we get caught up in the us versus them, and the, you know, our beliefs versus their beliefs and all that. When really, the fact of the matter is, as I was saying earlier, there is a darkness. There is an evil in this world, right? And we know it is principalities, right? And it is the devil and his army. And it is operating behind the curtain. And the Bible says that darkness will eventually come to the light. And when darkness comes to the light, there is zero chance for darkness. And I just want us to pray together for that, for the darkness to be exposed. Because it's more than politics. I don't even think the politicians even have that much power in this world. They really don't. There are people in charge of lots more wealth and lots more decisions than politicians. And there is just a spirit of control. And there is a spirit behind it that wants us all to be dissentious. That wants us all to be against each other, you know? I mean, probably a lot of us in the room have similar beliefs, but even if you have people that have completely different beliefs, this darkness wants us to just be in dissension, because then no one's actually exposing it. So let's just pray, if you guys can agree, that what we pray for is light to be shining on the darkness. And we pray for just good in this world. I know as you guys have seen in your lifetime that you know, in this country, it seemed to be, even when I was a kid 20 years ago, it seemed to be more good, less fear, you know? And now there's just more fear. Like, I wouldn't let my daughter ride her bike around my city. When I was a kid, we rode our bikes around the city, you know? And there's just a spirit of fear that's coming because of this whole thing. So, God, we just pray, God. We pray, we intercede right now, God, for your light to shine, God. For your fire, your all-consuming fire to come, God, and for it to shine, we pray that the darkness and the deeds of the evil, of the enemy, and all of his principalities and all of his army, that those deeds become exposed in the name of Jesus, God. We pray that this country, God, can become united, Lord. Come united in the war against evil, God. And we know as this comes, God, as unity comes, Father, your spirit will come with it, God. And Father God, that we will see revival, God. When this world begins to be sick of everything that's happening, God, and looking for a solution, Jesus, you are the solution. And so, God, we just pray, Father God. We pray that us, as a people of God, that we would be that water, God, to be added, God, that solution, God, to the world, and that we would show, Lord, that it is love, God, that it is your love, God, that it is your peace, God, that comes in and takes over. God, it is your Holy Spirit that changes us, God. And Lord, we pray, God, for those doors to be opened, God, for those gates to be lifted, Father God, that your Holy Spirit may come and just spark a revival and just spark a huge turnaround in this country, God, and in this world, Lord. That all people of all religions, God, would come to know you, Jesus. We're not asking that people lose their culture, God. But we're asking, Father God, that they would know you, Father Jesus. That your Holy Spirit will come into so many hearts in this world, God. Because we know when your Holy Spirit comes in, Lord, from there it's a wrap. That you just constantly change, mature, and perfect us, Jesus. So we pray. We speak light into the darkness. We speak light into the darkness. Jesus. Amen. Can we give the worship team a great applause? Thank you. I'm just getting over a sore throat, you know, when you have that phlegm stuff, and it's just kind of there. That was kind of me all day, so. Praise Jesus, we got through a worship set without voices. Well, if you don't know me, most of you in here know me. My name's Chris Traina. I am, this is my wife, Christina, and we are part of a church, a Foursquare church in Vallejo, North Bay Foursquare, and this is Asa. He is a young man who, go ahead and give him a applause. He's a great friend, and he is a very gifted drummer. He's a studio musician, so very blessed to have him come down and just worship with his drums. And Paul, also a good friend, and he graduated from Bethel School of Supernatural Ministry. So he's officially like spiritual and stuff. And if you just throw Bethel Supernatural School graduate, all of a sudden you walk in the room, you got clout, right? It's just great to be able to worship. Let me get my notes here. So I've been kind of on this message in my heart for about the last month since I went to a retreat. Is it loud enough? I don't know. You can turn the gain up a little bit. I just don't want to get back. Okay. Yeah, that's good. All right, that's better. Yeah. So I was at a retreat, and I was talking to someone during workshops, and I didn't go to the workshop. We had our own little workshop, and it was really good conversation, and I felt like there was something in it that was revelatory, and I wanted to dig further. If you guys don't know me, I'm going to do a quick testimony of who I am. So basically I grew up in this area. This is my hometown. Sunnyvale is my hometown. I was born in Santa Cruz, but moved here when I was a wee little one. And did my life thing. And when I was 18 or 17, my father died. My father died of a drug overdose. He was a good father. He wasn't a deadbeat dad, but he had a problem with addiction. And he was clean and sober for a while and got into a bad car accident and got prescribed pain medicine, and it really kicked his habit, and he ended up just going down a dark hole and ended up dying from a drug overdose. And it was kind of the beginning of my depression, and I just tried to live life and try to find that comfort and that fulfillment in the things of the world, like so many of us, fruitlessly did. And long story short, when I was like in my junior year of college, I just really developed a really bad social anxiety disorder. I felt uncomfortable around people. I felt awkward. I felt like there was something wrong with me. And I was really depressed. I just could not escape negativity. And so I couldn't work. I ended up, being homeless. And I was actually living in, there's a hotel on El Camino, the Hotel Levante. Most people probably never noticed it, but it's on the border of El Camino, Sunnyvale, and Mountain View. And I was actually living under an indoor staircase in the hotel for about a month, just sleeping underneath that because there was little patio or pool furniture underneath the staircase. So I was able to sleep there comfortably, and I could hide underneath it. But that was not the life that you imagine, right? You don't see yourself at the age of 25 like the prime years of your life physically sleeping under a staircase. And so I remember crying out, God help me. And a few days later I was at Washington Park and Mark and another guy, Paul, they reached out. Well, I reached out for a cigarette. I used to smoke cigarettes, and they reached out to pray for me. And from there on, I gave my life to the Lord, and not too much longer, I moved in with the Paulsons, Pastor Ron and Christine, and you know, when I moved in, I was just, you know, some young guy that was had a little bit of an attitude problem and a little bit depressed, and they took me in, which is brave, first of all, to take in some stranger to live with you. But it was some of the most cherished and valuable four or five years of my life living with them. And you know, I didn't have a dad when my dad died. And it was kind of one of those no one's going to replace my dad type feelings, you know, and I would be reluctant. Even my mom got remarried and you know, I called him by his first name. We couldn't replace my dad. And but, you know, if you guys know Pastor Ron, I mean, when you think of a fatherly figure, I mean, he is a father, and he's become, you know, my dad, like in all aspects. And so I just want to honor him for a second, you know, because he's kind of the one running this ministry.
Yes.
And it's amazing how hard he works, and you don't know it. He's so humble. But I mean, when I was there, he was like, we had a Sunday morning church service. We had a Saturday night, the homeless outreach, the refuge. We would do a gathering at the Salvation Army. We would do a gathering at the Salvation Army where we would reach out to drug addiction. We'd go to the city team, and he would always take up new ministries. He's had so many healing room, all these different ministries, because he just loves people so much. He just wants to see hurting, broken people be healed. And I know that's his heart more than anything. And so I just want to honor him. If we can just give an applause for him, because he's just such a great man. I love you. You're really special. And of course, his wife, who I know he couldn't do any of that without. Most definitely. It's just an amazing woman. You saw her around the house constantly cleaning up after me when I lived there without even a complaint. Was my wife would tell you would be one of the most amazing feats ever, and she did that. But she's just so loving and you know, just so helpful to so many, and they're a great family. I can go on and on, but I won't. They took me in, and you know, I finished college. I got married to my wife, who's an amazing worshiper, and we have little children who are running around here screaming earlier. And so, I mean, it's just, I remember one time Mark told me, like, he said to me, you know, you're the greatest success story that I know. Because really what happened is God just took me from the lowest of the lowest. I mean, I was homeless with nothing, living under a staircase. And just like 4 years, you know, finished college, you know, got a girlfriend, got married, got a job at Apple. You know, it's just so fast. God just restored me so quickly. And he is in that. He's in the business of reconciliation and restoration. And that's what he does. And it's just so amazing. I just love talking about my testimony. And go on and on about stories of that, but some people here have probably heard them all many times, so I'll go into the message of today. Unwavering faith. How many in here, you can raise your hand if you want, or you can just nod your head, do you have unwavering, doubtless faith? I don't see a lot of hands being raised or heads being nodded, right? That's often the response. If anything comes up where it's like, are you a great, you know, perfect, people are going to obviously go, oh, well, no. Because, you know, in and of ourselves, we're not. But the thing is about unwavering faith, when we need something, when we are praying for something, obviously faith is kind of that vehicle that brings things into existence. I mean, the whole concept of us having a relationship with an invisible God is obviously based on faith. But I remember there was a time I was having some really bad health problems, ringing in my ears and just nerve pain, and it was just really bad. And I was feeling like, even though I was praying a lot, I wasn't getting healed because I just didn't have enough faith. You guys ever kind of encounter that, like you just feel like your faith is insufficient enough to bring the healing. And you have this feeling of, I'm like almost mustering up faith. And I remember walking out one night, and I used to, when I lived in Sunnyvale, I live in Vallejo now, so I don't really do this as much. I used to walk out at like 10 o'clock at night and pray. Vallejo, probably not the best area to do that in. I would walk out, pray for Vallejo. I think it's a great city. Some of people here, we have Ray and Elmarie. These are people from our church as well. They're missionaries who have traveled the world from South Africa to China, right? You guys were in China for a while. And God has called them to Vallejo, and they are champions for Vallejo. And Vallejo it's got a lot of crime, and it's got a lot of murder. There's been a lot of homicides in Vallejo, but it's got so much promise. It's got so much hope. It's a beautiful city. It's on the water. It's waterfront property with rolling hills. It's just a beautiful city, and there's just been words over Vallejo. And so you can see this contrast there of the violence, of the darkness, but of the light and the hope. And so we really believe that Vallejo is going to be the first like fully restored city in America, really, where it's just everyone in the city just has a relationship with God. And it's been a great turnaround. You guys may remember Vallejo used to be bankrupt. And some of you probably still think it's bankrupt, but actually it's no longer bankrupt. It came out of bankruptcy. There was actually an article in the Washington Post. Is that the big Washington, D.C. one or Times? One of those. The big one. One of the biggest. Washington Post, I think it is. If you Google Vallejo Washington Post, you will find the first article. Washington Post wrote an article that Vallejo should be a model of the cities. In the United States that are bankrupt, and there's lots of them, of how we were able to come out of that. And we know it's by the grace of God. We had a mayor who, a strong believing mayor, they get together with the mayor, was it weekly? Weekly, and they pray, and the mayor will receive words of prophecy, and just declares God over the city. And it's amazing. He won the voting by two votes, you know. And it's since he's been in office, it's went from being bankrupt to really excelling. We're having a lot of big companies move into Vallejo. They're even talking about, I think, the next Star Wars being made there in Mare Island, which used to be a naval base. When they left is really when Maryland closed is when the economy went down. So anyways, Vallejo, great city. Please pray for it. I think you guys will hear some great things coming out of that city. Don't believe all the things you see on the news too about Vallejo. So anyways, I don't know how I got there, but doubtless faith. Do you have it? So I was out there praying at night, and I was thinking, okay, I got a muster faith. So it's almost like a boxer walking into a ring. You know, when a boxer, you see them, they're getting into the ring, and they're really getting amped up. They're getting ready to fight, you know? And it's kind of how I was coming to the Lord. Okay, I'm going to muster up faith, and I'm going to really have a lot of faith, and I'm going to just declare healing, and I'm going to get healing. And I'm sure a lot of people in this room have had that, where it's like they feel like they need more faith, and they can muster it up and whatnot. And I remember God showing me a story. And I wrote a song. I'm going to share the song with you in a second, because the song goes with the story. But you guys know the story about Jesus in the boat when there was a hurricane, basically, in the water. Because he's in a boat full of fishermen who have much experience on the water. And they were afraid they were going to drown, because there was a big storm that brewed up and water was coming on the boat. And if you're in a boat, one thing you don't want in the boat with you is the water that you're floating on, right? That's probably the last thing you want to see on the boat. And so the water was coming on the boat, and Jesus, what was Jesus doing? Sleeping, right? Yeah, no worries with Jesus. He's sleeping. He obviously was really tired from ministering all day, every day. And so he's sleeping, and disciples are like, Jesus, wake up. We're going to die. We're going to drown here, right? I mean, it was a really bad storm for fishermen to say that, right? They weren't joking. They were seriously thinking they were going to die. What do you think the fishermen's faith was at that point? What was their faith in their ability to handle a boat or a storm? Nothing. They had no faith. They thought they were going to die, even though the Son of God was in the boat with them. They thought they were going to die. So, you know, the thing that Jesus was showing me was like, look, even though they had no faith, Jesus still stopped the storm. It wasn't their faith in whatever they had that stopped the storm, but Jesus still did it anyways. And it brought me comfort because I realized that I don't have to. I don't have to muster up some sort of faith in me for a miracle to happen. I mean, he stopped a hurricane basically with his hand and his voice and a command. And I think it's important for us to know. So can I share that song? I'm just going to share that song. I think it ministers to anyone that's also going through some sort of sickness or hurt like I was at the time. And yeah, it has a, I think the words are on the screen.
Jesus, I heard the pain is too much. Jesus, come near, I need your healing touch. Jesus, I believe, please take away my doubt. I got a mustard seed, will you carry the rest out? I wanna wash your feet with my tears. I wanna lay my head on your chest. I want you to take away all of my fears. I'm a ship in the storm. Will you tell the wind to rest?
With our tears like Mary Magdalene did in the scriptures. And even the man, you know, I said, I have a mustard seed, please take away my doubt. And it's like the man that came to the Lord for his son, and he said, I believe, help my unbelief. And you read through the scriptures, you read through the scriptures of so many people that lacked faith. I mean, Abraham is the father of faith. And when God told him he was going to have kids, he went and made a child with his servant because he obviously lacked faith. So what is it about this where Jesus says, oh yeah, there's a button here. Jesus says, I tell you the truth, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what has been done to the fig tree when he told the fig tree to die and it died, but even say to this mountain, be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and it will happen. So whenever we come to scripture, we see something like this where it says, I tell you the truth, if you have faith and do not doubt. A lot of times we then look at ourselves, right? We go, oh, if I have faith and I don't doubt. Okay, so we kind of look at ourselves, and what we do is we're going to the word and we're taking from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Does that tree sound familiar? See, Adam and Eve ate from that tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the tree of knowledge of right and wrong, right? And it is what it is. It's not just some evil tree. They ate of the tree, and they gained a knowledge of right and wrong, of good and evil, right? And what happens is, when you eat of that tree, the first thing you look at is yourself. Because what happened when they ate of that tree? What's the first thing they did? They realized they were naked. They saw fault in themselves, right? It was a fig tree. I'm convinced of that they ate. It wasn't an apple tree, because obviously after they ate of the fig tree, what were the leaves that they sowed on themselves? Fig leaves. And also, there's also a scripture in Ezekiel where it goes on some crazy rant about bad figs, evil figs, and good figs, which doesn't make sense if you're talking about actual figs. But the fig tree, I believe, was the fruit of that tree. Not that figs are evil now. But anyways, so you come to scripture, and it's the same thing. When you read a scripture like this, you could take from that fruit. And your immediate reaction is, there's something wrong with me, I have doubt. Now, when we go to the tree of life, we don't look at ourselves. We end up looking at Jesus. And so, we're talking about doubtless faith here. And I'm going to convince you guys that you absolutely do have doubtless faith. And it's not going to take long, because it's just going to be the next scripture. Okay. I'm sure. Morris, the most evangelistic, that guy will go get his car washed and the whole lot will be saved by the time he leaves. Probably knows the scripture very well. It's so paramount. And a lot of times if I walked up to somebody and I said, how are you saved? What do you need to do to be saved? And probably if I asked you guys that, what do you need to do to be saved? There'd probably be a long-winded answer. It'd all be right. I mean, you guys all would understand the gist of what you need to do to be saved. But the thing is, there's some scriptures in the Bible where it's so plain as day. It's pretty simple. What do you need to do to be saved? It's right here. And it's not even something you have to interpret. Because at the very end it says, you will be saved. What do you have to do? Declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. And believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. And you will be saved. Right? Sometimes you read scripture like, wow, that's in there? Like, another scripture that's funny. People always, if you ask, what is God's will? What is God's will for me? What's God's will for me? And you'll probably you'll seek prophetic word. What's God's will for my life? But there's an actual scripture that says, this is God's will for your life. Do you know what it is? Does anyone know what that scripture is? Be thankful. It says, be thankful. Does it say be thankful in all things?
Yeah.
Be thankful in all things, for this is God's will in your life. In Christ Jesus. So, there's these scriptures sometimes where it's like, that's pretty much slapping me in the face with, like, the obvious. So, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. So here's the thing. I'm assuming most of you guys are in here believers. If you're not, then we can, you know, pray for you afterwards. But, could I convince any of you believers in here that Jesus isn't Lord? Is there ever a doubt in your mind that Jesus is Lord? do you ever waver on that at all? Is there a doubt in your mind that God raised Jesus from the dead? Can I talk you out of that? Could someone try to give you some sort of like facts that dead people can't be raised and talk you out of that? You have absolute, unwavering faith in Jesus and who he is. Unwavering. You have that doubtless faith in him. That's the tree of life, right? When you come to the Word and you start looking at yourself, there's doubt, of course. But when you come to the Word and you eat from the tree of life, it's always going to point to him. And so, just like in the boat, they didn't look at themselves, doubt. We're going to die. But they look at him, maybe we got a chance, right? Let's wake him up, right? Same thing. Because when it comes to that, there is that. He basically, what Jesus is with this, so basically what I'm telling you is, you have this little tiny bit of faith in you that's unshakable, right? You have this, I'm just showing you something, that there is something in your life that is unshakable, that is unwavering. You have it in you. And know what that is? That's the mustard seed that Jesus is talking about. It's the mustard seed of faith that is needed to move a mountain. Because the Bible is this, it's so amazing because it's living and active, truly, right? You read stuff, and if you dig deep enough, you almost go like, is that coincidence? Did that happen on purpose? Did you mean for that? And you can just always, you just dig and dig and dig, and you'll just find stuff that no one's ever even seen before. And it's just so amazing. So when you look at the scripture, this one, this is after the fig tree. It's the same thing happened to the fig tree, right? The story of the fig tree, where this comes from, is Jesus was walking down a hill, obviously hungry, because he's been working all day, probably not eating, saw a fig tree with leaves out of season for figs. So there's not supposed to be figs on this tree, but it is kind of odd that there's leaves on it anyways, because it was not during a season that there's supposed to be even leaves on the fig tree. So he walks up to the tree, and there's no figs on it, and he cursed the fig tree to die. Now, there's a lot of levels that we can approach scripture. And the first superficial level makes Jesus look like a pretty mean person, right? Well, I mean, we all get grumpy when we're hungry. Lord knows, even today I was grumpy with my wife when I was really hungry. And you could say, well, Jesus might have just been really grumpy because he's human, and he cursed the fig tree because it had no figs on it. But that'd be a little unfair because it wasn't even fig season. I mean, you're kind of expecting a lot, Jesus, right? Expecting for figs to be on a tree when it's not even the season for that, right? So that could be the first layer. You'd be like, well, Jesus was just mad that he was hungry and there are no figs on it, right? The next layer goes into where you, if you read about this, a lot of times the interpretation of the scripture is if you're not fruitful, then you're going to be, Jesus, you know, going to cut you off, right? That's sometimes how people get at it. And I think that that is eating from the tree of knowledge of right and wrong, which is not the tree you want to eat from. Because what's happening there is people are coming to the Word. People that are saved, great theologians, get this interpretation. They're coming to the Word, and then they're seeing what's wrong in themselves, right? I'm not fruitful enough. You know, I don't want Jesus to curse me and that I die, so I got to be more fruitful. And that's looking at ourselves. And that's not what needs to happen here. See, I read something that was amazing, and it was a pretty long thing on it, but basically, where that happened, the fig tree, was very close to where he actually was crucified. It was in that same, it was within, 50 yards away of the skull, of the hill of the skull or whatever. And there was something incredibly prophetic and symbolic in that he was coming to the tree that was a symbol of man's failure. Basically, he being God saw this tree, you know, what the act that happened because of this is why I have to come here and I have to lay my life down, is why there's so much pain and hurt in this world. And he cursed to die, and shortly thereafter, he raised up on a tree right near there. And it's such a beautiful thing that the old man, because of what he did, the old man died. And he raised, and he and the new man come to life because of what he did. And it's you can look at the scripture, and when you get an interpretation of the word like that, then all of a sudden, if you hear something like that, and that, the thing about the word is there's a million truths to a word, right? Like, that was one truth, and from what you hear from it, like, wow, that makes a lot of sense, right? Like, that's awesome. You know it's really a truth. You know you're eating from the tree of life when the result of what you read and what you got out of it made you grateful for Jesus. It's pretty simple. It's almost Sunday school. It just comes back to always the answer is Jesus. And so I'm saying that because we all love the Word. We read the Word. And if you feel yourself being condemned from the Word, it's okay. Sometimes you get convicted. That's okay. But if you see yourself being made into something that lacks, then you're probably approaching it from right and wrong. That's our natural tendency. That's our human nature, is to have this discernment of right and wrong, which in the spiritual world, that's not where we live. We live in life. Jesus, Holy Spirit, tells us everything. We don't need to worry about figuring out what's right and wrong. Now, that's not easy operating in this world, but in the spirit realm, that's all we got. And so I just want to share that because I love the Word. I know you guys love the Word. And when we come to the Word, we just always ask, Lord, I want to eat from the tree of life when I read these scriptures. And so, what's the example he gave here? When you have faith and do not doubt, what will happen? You will, and this is the fig tree, you will take to the mountain, be thrown into the sea, and it will happen. Well, remember earlier I was just talking about how you all have the mustard seed in you. All of you guys have whatever is needed to perform the most impossible of miracles, telling a mountain to move, right? Because all of us in here have that mustard seed. Have that mustard seed. So when we go to, when we come to a place where someone is asking for prayer for something we seem, it seems is impossible, we just realize, Jesus, I have unwavering faith that you are Lord. I have unwavering faith that God raised you from the dead. I have no doubt. So I have the mustard seed. That's all I need, you said, Lord. That's all I need. We don't have to muster up any more faith. Interesting, muster up. I don't have to muster up anymore. We had it. Unshakable. You guys already confirmed. It's unshakable. I can't convince you otherwise. Not related to the fig tree. A different situation altogether. Jesus used the same exact example. Is that coincidence? I don't think so. Tell you the truth, if you have faith like a grain of mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. So, in the one situation with the fig tree, he says, don't doubt. And then we go to Romans 10:9, and we see we have that mustard seed of faith in Jesus, and we go to another part of his word. It's like a puzzle. You just put stuff together, and you realize, same thing, he's saying the same thing. Like, look, mountains move with that little bit of faith that you have. You don't doubt in that little bit. You might doubt on everything else, but that little bit, that's where we're operating from. That's where we operate from, is that place of unwavering faith, which is in him. That's it. Not in our abilities, because we have doubts there. But in him, we don't have any doubt of who he is. Sometimes we might doubt what we think he can do through us, but it doesn't matter, because once we start looking at us again, wrong tree, right? So, tell your neighbor that they have unwavering faith. You have unwavering faith. Where are you having unwavering faith? Can't talk you out of Jesus being the Son of God, raising from the dead. So, just want to, it might be kind of unrelated, but I feel like I should share it. It kind of was the conversation I was having with somebody, which got us to the place where we were talking about this. I miss living with Mark, because there's someone at my church that is very reminiscent of Mark to me, someone I can have a conversation with that is just really deep, and you just talk about deep things of the scripture. And with Mark, we would sit outside, and we would just like, I'd say, yeah, this doesn't make any sense in the scripture. And we'd kind of talk about it. We'd go back and forth. And by the end of the conversation, it was just like we just discovered some, like, treasure, you know, that we wouldn't have discovered before. You know, it's just, that's really what church is. That's what fellowship is when you come together and you, you know, have that, those discussions of the word. And I used to do that so much with Mark. And anyways, I was doing that again with this guy. So I wanted to kind of brief on something I would guess call the currency of suffering. Because the fact is, when it comes to miracles and when it comes to things that we need faith for, usually it's the result of somebody suffering, right? Or something is suffering that gets us to this place where we think I need faith to break through, right? And we hate suffering, you know? We love knowing that we're going to be in a place where there is no more suffering, where there is no sorrow, there is no pain. So what is this suffering, and what is this, what does it mean? And you have some parts of the church that say, you know, God gave me this sickness, and you got some parts of the church that say, God can't give you any sickness, and it's very confusing to try to sort it out. And we're not God; we can't discern His ways. Now, I kind of sit on the fence, in a sense, because based on what I see from the scriptures, what I've seen is there has been some instances where God almost kind of gave a sickness. For example, you look at Moses. He was on the Mount Sinai, and God told him to put his hand in his cloak, put his hand out. What did he have? He had leprosy. It wasn't like, it didn't say he thought he had leprosy. No, it said he had leprosy. And then God said, put your hand back in your cloak. Pull it out. What happened? No leprosy, right? Well, let's look at another example. Paul, the apostle. Jesus came. What happened? And Paul, the very first time Paul, he was killing people. He was Saul. He was killing people. Jesus came. What happened to him? He went blind. Was it fake blind? Did he know he was going to get better? He walked away from that situation saying, I had an encounter with Jesus and I can't see anymore. I mean, you don't have to do much interpretation to go, my encounter with Jesus got me blind. But what happened 3 days later? He went and saw Simon, and because God told him to in his story, and what happened? No more blindness. Now, so I'd say, what I say is, could God give sickness? I don't like to think so. But what I do know is this. In the scripture, every single time that God did give sickness, the person was healed not too much longer afterwards. Right? I mean, talking a few minutes, talking a few days. Right? So I don't have to try to figure out the whole meaning of sickness. But I do already know that God heals all sickness, and He wants to heal all sickness, and He has healed all sickness. There's not a single instance in the Bible where He hasn't. You know, sometimes it took an extra prayer because someone saw trees walking, or, you know. But the thing is, so what is this suffering? Why is it? So what happened with me this summer, it was already a pretty big jump on last summer, because last summer I've been having a lot of health problems, and I took this test called the Oncoblot test. It's a very sensitive test to find precursors for cancer. It's actually a really good test. It should be a test that should be given to all people. It's just a basic blood test. They send it to a laboratory, and then it not only does it tell you if you have precursors for a malignancy, or if you might even have a malignancy, it tells you where it is, which that sounds like a pretty amazing thing, right? It is 96% effective. So basically, it took thousands of people that had cancer. They had them do this test, and it said, yeah, you have cancer in the prostate. Yeah, you have cancer in the colon. And it was accurate 96% of the time. Like, obviously, if something like this was made very marketable, and every single person on a basic blood test could give blood every year, and it says, you better watch out. There's some proteins, because there's a certain protein that occurs in tumors. There's some proteins that are developing in this area that is showing you to be at risk or potentially even have cancer, right? That would save a lot of lives if that was the case. I go into a lot of stuff, but when I'm talking about the darkness, obviously there's a pharmaceutical companies that don't want a lot of lives being saved because they're making billions and billions by people being sick, right? So anyways, I took that test and it said that I had malignancies in my colon, and so I was scared, obviously, not knowing. Do I have colon cancer? The doctor that took the test, I had to pay out of my pocket for that test. It's not a test that the insurance covers, and it's pretty expensive too. I think it's like $600 or something. And so, the doctor said it could be polyps, it could be something else, it could be cancer, but you need to go see a real gastroenterologist to get it all checked out. I got checked out. I've been diagnosed with ulcerative colitis, which is it's a disease. It's an autoimmune disease. It's not just it's not the same as there's a disease and then there's like basically a disorder. This is a disease, so it's an autoimmune disease, and it causes inflammation in your colon. And long-term inflammation is basically what causes a lot of cancer. And so that's what why that test popped up, because they looked at everything and there was no tumors, praise God. But I waited from when I got that test that said you may have cancer to when I actually was able to get the camera work and all that stuff done. It was probably like 7 months. They don't move fast, especially when you have a test like that. That's not something that most doctors even know about, right? So it didn't move very fast. And in that time, it's tempting to freak out, right? A lot of people here in this church prayed for me, and I had people everywhere praying for me. I know some people, when they get something like that, they hide it, and I'm the opposite. I tell everybody so I can get prayer. You know, sometimes my wife, something happens, okay, before you go and tell everybody on Facebook, can we just talk about it first? I got all that prayer. And I really dove in to all things cancer treatment, you know? And I just see, man, there's just so much deceit out there, you know? For example, I read, there's a site called Chris Beat Cancer, not me, Chris, but a different Chris. And he had colon cancer. He chose not to get chemo, and he naturally healed. And he started his website, and there's just tons and tons of people that have gone the same route. And even now, there's so many doctors that are making progress in natural treatment for cancer, and there's been about 38 of them that have actually been murdered. And it's being set up, a lot of them are being set up as suicide. But there's progress being made in that, and I was doing all this research and seeing, like, and there was a study in Australia with like 13,000 people, and they found that actually chemotherapy is only 2% effective in cancer treatment. But yet, everyone who gets cancer is chemotherapy, right? And that's been going on since 1960-something, when they first designed that. And so, I really was digging deep and finding all these different like ways to treat it. And I went on this protocol where I was, you know, eating like cottage cheese with flaxseed oil and 5 pounds worth of carrot juice every day and all this stuff, and really helped my health a lot. But the thing is since then, there's been a few people, very close people, family members, that have been diagnosed with cancer. Mm-hmm. I had a cousin, one of Christina's cousins. She's only like 34. She was diagnosed with breast cancer, and so she only had stage one breast cancer, which, if you don't know about the staging, all that means is that there's a tumor that's cancerous and it hasn't spread at all. Not even the least bit. Because the different stage two means it's spread to local lymph nodes. Stage three, it's spread to organs. Stage four, it's spread to multiple organs. And hope is a little more bleak to the world, but not to God. And so anyways, she had stage one. She had a cancerous tumor and they removed it from her. And then the doctor told her, you need chemo. And she was saying something on Facebook like, okay, I had stage one cancer and I'm going into chemo in 2 weeks. And I was like, whoa, we need to talk. And so she came over and I said, you had stage one cancer, it's gone, there's no more cancer in you, so why are they giving you chemo? And then she said, well, they think I'm high risk and they want to do something just in case. And I said, so they want to poison your entire immune system. You guys know when people get chemo, I mean, not only do they get incredibly sick, and not only do they lose all the hair, but it's so bad for the immune system. A lot of people that, if you know someone that had chemo, they can't, like, they have to stay in the house because their immune system is so weakened. And they want to just destroy your whole systems just in case, because you might have something. And I basically encourage her, because I'm not a doctor, but I encourage her to go get a second opinion at least. Like, when we go and buy it, I've seen, you know, Pastor Dad, I call him, when he wants to buy a printer, he does about 2 days worth of research and, you know, checks like every printer in the world to find out which one to save $15, right?
Yeah.
Christine knows what I'm talking about. Meanwhile, people have something wrong and they go to a doctor who makes a recommendation and they just go with it. And they don't go to another doctor. They don't research themselves. They just trust this one doctor. Now, doctors have made great advancements, especially in the surgical and emergency services. Those doctors are amazing. But I'm kind of going off subject, but I still think it's interesting. I hope you guys are interested in this. But anyways, like, it's your life. It's your body, you know? Like, obviously, you have to do some research. So this person, she went and talked to other doctors. She ended up not getting chemo. Like, chemo is not only so bad, sure, it's 2% effective, but then the rest of the percent, like, people, it opens up the door to so much more cancer because of your immune system being absolutely shot. And it opens up the door to other sicknesses. And it also does damage. I mean, people have, they call it like cancer brain and all this stuff from the chemo. And I had a friend of mine who is a believer. Also, she's part of our church. She was diagnosed with aggressive melanoma, which is the second deadliest cancer that there is, right behind pancreatic cancer. So she just had a baby, and they found this cancer, and the doctors told her that she won't live to see her son's 1 year old birthday. And tragic, right? And so this was before I even knew anything about it. I didn't know her at this point, but she kind of reacted the same way I did. You know, she has the faith. She gets the prayers. She went up to Bethel. She had this amazing story about, like, at one point, like, when she was praying, when she first got the diagnosis, she was praying every night. And she would always see the vision of the woman with the blood problem going to Jesus to be healed. And then she went up to Bethel one time. And then, like, they said, anyone else cancer, stand up. She stood up, and they just did a quick prayer, and she sat down. She felt kind of, like, unfulfilled. Like, I came all the way here, and all I got was, like, you're healed in Jesus' name, yeah, right? But then she said, her husband had just went to the bathroom, and someone walked up and gave her, like, a letter. And in the letter, it talked about, it said, I see the woman with blood, and that, you know, you're that woman. And she was just broken up. You know, and she knows at that point something happened. But then she also went with the same kind of education I went with the natural treatments and did all these things. And here she is 5 years later, no cancer in her body, right? Isn't that amazing? And God is so good. And so I think it's an important story because, just telling a million stories. Stories are not boring anyways, right? So I get to tell a story. Because I remember this one time I was at a gas station, and there was a homeless guy, kind of walked up to me, asked for me some money. I gave some money, and I heard God say to tell him that things will turn around for him. And I just tell him things are going to turn around. And so I turned, and he was kind of gone. He went behind the building, and I was like, oh well, I guess I missed him, you know, sorry. And then I sat in my car, I was ready to leave, and God said, if you don't tell him, it won't happen. And you think about the scripture, Jesus didn't just show up to the world and gave his life and all of a sudden, you know, the sins were all taken away of the world. There was many, many, many prophecies before that. It's like almost, in a sense, it's showing that in order for something to happen, a prophetic word has to be released first, right? It has to be released for the miracle to happen. So whenever you see all these prophecies in the scriptures, it's for a reason. Because God operates by the same laws that he set up for us, which is the word has to be given first for the act to take place, right? And so, like, in the case of my friend who had this, you know, less than a year to live, that person in Bethel got a word. She's sitting there, she sees someone in her row stand up for you know, cancer, and she heard a word. And she could have maybe just said, I don't know, I'm not. But she was submitted to that. And she took that time, and she gave the word to her. And when she received that word, she felt something happen. And she moved forward, and she was healed. And I say that because it's so important for us when we do hear a word, or even just to listen to a word, that we know that it's that's the case, is that the word comes before the act, you know, and it does. So, I was going through all these things, and it brings me back to the currency of suffering. Like, why do we suffer? If I never went through what I went through, the suffering that I went through. I mean, not only did it pay dividends in my life that I've discovered healthier ways of eating. I've cut out like all processed junk. I still juice, you know, carrots like every day. You know, my wife sees me in there peeling carrots every night. It's almost relaxing for me, just peeling carrots. Like, and juicing. The carrot juice is pretty good. Anyways, so the currency of suffering, and if I never went through that. Now, whenever even if talked to her cousin, saved her from getting unnecessary chemotherapy, right? And just there's been so many people now that I've met with, and my friend who had the melanoma, she started a nonprofit to teach people who have cancer about the natural alternatives to treatment that are out there. And I've helped her with that, helped her fundraising with that, and talking and educating people with her. And, you know, it's just, there was a suffering, and I was given a good free notice from the doctors that it wasn't as bad as it seemed, but for me going through that has helped so many. And so, some of you may be suffering, some of you may know someone. Me and my wife, we have a ministry. It's kind of a new ministry. Actually, the flyer for this was the first time we made it public, really, about... Well, we go into people's homes and we worship. It started about a couple of years ago when a pastor from our church, son, was almost died, and he still has brain damage, and it's affecting him still. But he's improved along the way. But he was almost pretty much on his deathbed, like he could have died at any moment. And we thought to come down and come into his room and just worship, and just invite the presence, because you know when you're in the presence. All these things, all the pain, it's almost it leaves you for a second, right? You just kind of go above this earth. And so we ministered, and from that day we've seen growth in him. He still has issues, but he doesn't stop making progress, which is the big thing with anyone with brain damage, is when they start making progress is when you need to start worrying. And he continues to make progress. And so we did that with him. I had a friend who had a baby who was in really bad shape. It's something that starts with V, like bars or something like that. It's a five different things that need surgery. It's a heart situation. The esophagus, instead of going to the stomach, the esophagus goes straight to the lungs when they're born, so they can't eat. So they have to do surgery to move the esophagus to the stomach. You know, heart surgery, there's problems with the back, problem with the finger, all sorts of issues, and, you know, it's, baby might not even live. And my friend, who was always a non-believer, he was always, you know, kind of on the atheist side of things, reached out to me and my wife to pray. And I said, hey, let's, you know, because I offered it. I said, hey, I know you don't believe in God, but me and my wife do, and we believe that God can heal. And we'd like to go pray. You know, you don't even have to believe. And so we went down there, and it's almost like we acted like Jesus in the boat, right? I mean, the disciples, they didn't believe, but Jesus did do the believing for them. And the same thing, we went down there, we're in the room, and we're praying, and I'm leading him to pray. And while I'm in there praying, I'm like, I feel like God's saying, you know, for you to actually speak this over your son. You know, I was just trying to explain to him, like, hey, you know, you're like the priest in the home, trying to get some theology into him, even though that way they were. And he was. Him and his wife, they were praying over his son, and he is making progress. Got surgeries. He's moving around now. He's doing well. They think that he's going to have a pretty much normal life. He might have some physical, you know, difficulties, but by no means will he be, like, you know, in terrible shape. And so it was like, wow, we've gone to a couple of sick people and we've seen some things happen. And so another friend of ours, whose dad has been placed on hospice, he was diagnosed with prostate cancer a while ago. And he went down to Mexico to one of the leading natural treatment centers in the world, pretty expensive, but he went down there and he followed their regimen and their protocol for quite some time, and he was making great growth. They removed the cancer surgically, and there was no more cancer, and his PSA levels, all that, were good. And then he just, you know, naturally what happens to people when they're sick is they get better, and then they think they're all better, and they kind of revert. And so he stopped doing all of that, started, you know, drinking the beer and eating, you know, all the junk that you shouldn't be eating, and then a year later, the cancer came back kind of with a vengeance. And so, you know, he was placed on hospice, placed on his deathbed a couple of months ago, you know, 3 months or something like that. But we've gone there multiple times and just worship. And, you know, he's a pretty, like, masculine guy, one of those type of guys that you wouldn't think would one of those, like, I don't need them. He's a nice guy, but you wouldn't think of someone like that. That, you know, we come in and we do it, and I feel like, okay, we're doing this, we're ministering to him, but, you know, maybe he doesn't. But he actually requests all the time, can they come back? Can they come back? Like, all the time. He wants us back all the time to invite the presence, because when the presence comes in the room, and when Jesus' presence comes in the room, it's just like you feel healed. You just feel that way. And I think if you're in the presence long enough, you know, maybe you'll actually get healed, right? So we talked about, like, maybe this is our ministry. Maybe we're supposed to go into people's homes and just worship and release the presence. And so we put that on our flyer. I don't know if you guys saw it. We put it on a flyer that we go into people's homes and we minister to the sick and with worship. And so we just did that, and there was like 3 people that have already responded. So we feel like that's a ministry for us. I think our email's on the flyer. If not, you can get it from me later. We could try to arrange stuff. We live an hour away, but we come down here every so often. So if you know someone, you know, please do that. It's not like anything we do for money. A lot of times they give us a dinner, so that might be nice. But it's just, we just want people to be healed. And I think if you've seen how God has healed you, and you know what he's done for you, it's just your desire to see that in others. And so that's kind of our ministry. If you guys want to support that with prayer, if you guys know somebody that needs that, let us know. So I want to take the time, now that we have this faith, this unwavering faith, we know we have it, I want us to minister in here. So if I can have the people, my friends, and my team who want to come up and have a word. Paul, Asa, Ray, Elmarie, Christina, my love. We're just going to, I don't know if you guys have been in services where people do this, but basically, we're just going to have a word. If you look in 1 Corinthians 12, it has various gifts, right? There's a gift of a word of knowledge, which I've been in places where we were at a party where someone had a word of knowledge. Well, that she was pregnant. That was a pretty crazy one, because we didn't know we were pregnant at that time. And he actually said, I see a baby coming, like, very soon, like this year. And it was like late January. So it was like, the baby's coming this year. We weren't really planning on having a baby. And then we went home and she was actually pregnant. This guy was a great prophet. He was also, he got a word of knowledge of someone's name. So a word of knowledge is that, maybe someone might say, you know, your knee's hurting, I feel like God wants to heal that. A word of wisdom is just you know, a word that just speaks from heaven, that just into your life, that's just amazing. And then prophetic words, anything like that. So I'm just going to kind of hand it down here to my team, if they have something. Does anyone...
I believe I have the gift of faith, and that anything that you have here, in, whether it's spirit, soul, or body, God can take care of it. So my word to you is that Jesus can save, heal, deliver, transform, and anything that you have in your body or your soul that should not be there, I want to pray for you in the name of Jesus, and it's going to leave. That's it. So you just, you can stay there, let us know. You can come up here. The way that Jesus heals is limitless. It's not just one way. So we match our faith, even if you don't have faith. As Chris was saying many times, God healed without faith, but I believe that He can do everything. Everything.
I feel like someone has a left knee injury and also a neck trauma from an accident or something. I feel like some trauma.
So is that someone in here have a left knee situation going on? Left knee situation. What about neck trauma from an injury? Place that we have unwavering faith that Jesus is who He is. That's the faith we come in. Jesus, yeah, just go ahead and keep praying for her. And if I could have some people also come up to Christina over here on the piano, maybe lay some hands on her for the neck. But God released a word of knowledge in this place. It's amazing. For a neck, from a trauma, and a knee, there's one person for each. Very specific. And so, what, like I said earlier, when a word is released first before the act takes place, so that word has been released. So, Ray said he just received a word for someone that has a sciatic nerve issue. So anyone in here have a sciatic nerve issue? That's kind of the nerve here. It has that, and then. If you feel like that is you, stand up and then, what, did you say shoulder? Shoulder, okay. And Minga and Nancy, so go ahead and stand up if you have a shoulder issue. If you're around them, please, go ahead and stand up and Minga. Let's pray for them. God, we thank you that these words are being released, God, because we know that they come from a place of faith. That they are the vehicle, God, for the action to take place. God, we declare your healing in the name of Jesus. I speak the healing to the shoulders right now. After praying, ask them to test it out a little bit. Sometimes, just like with Jesus in the trees, the guy who couldn't see, and he prayed for him, and he kind of got his vision, he had to pray for him again. So, after you pray, ask for them to check it out a little bit. If it's still hurting, pray for it some more.
What?
If you have testimony, Please, feel free to share. Get testimony. You feel better? A little bit?
A lot of it.
If you feel, you might feel heat. Sometimes you feel a heat, a hot sensation come. That's the Holy Spirit working. If you feel something, testimony is what releases more, so please feel free to come up and... Okay.
A little better.
Okay, come here.
We have that unwavering faith in him. And Somewhere, I don't know if it's work maybe or something, I feel like almost there's like a magnifying glass. I don't know if it's on you or on a group of people or something, there's a magnifying glass. And it's almost like from their end, maybe it's something they're trying to pick apart or something in you. But that you have glory in you, and you wear it on your face. And that it's like when you take a magnifying glass, and then the sun shines, and then it can burn things. And I feel like that's what's gonna happen. It's like, whatever resistance is coming against you, I don't know from what, but that is working like that, through that magnifying glass, and that you're actually gonna be having an effect. You're gonna start to see an effect where you're kind of burning away. People are gonna be around you, and they're almost gonna, you're not saying anything about God, you're not saying anything about how to act, but they just feel something in you that almost burns something in them that shouldn't be there. That God's going to use you in that. I don't know if that speaks to you. But thank you, God, for the magnifying glass. What's your name?
Alice.
Yeah, thank you, God, for Alice, Lord, that she has your glory, that the light of your countenance truly is shining on her face. And Lord, that whatever this is, this magnifying glass and this resistance, God, we thank you that now she can come through this knowing that you are, I mean, it's easy to say that you're going to be glorified in it, but like in a very direct way, people are going to be affected because of Alice, and she doesn't even have to say anything. She just is shows the light of the countenance. Jesus' name, thank you.
Problems. The Lord wants to heal them. They have some kind of a waters in their eyes. The Lord wants to